Malcolm Chisholm, we are indeed monitoring that and we will ensure it is a priority going forward.
Thank you. We now move to First Minister's questions. Question number one, Kezia Dugdale.
With your permission, Presiding Officer, I think I speak for the whole of Scotland when I say it was a great relief to wake up to the news this morning that Pauline Cafferkey is on the mend. Can I ask... Can I ask the First Minister what engagement she has planned for the rest of the day?
First Minister.
Well, Presiding Officer, I was also delighted to hear that Pauline Cafferkey, a brave and inspirational woman, is recovering and recovering well, and I'm sure we wish her all the best as she continues to regain her strength. This afternoon, I'll be seeking urgent talks with the UK Government about the announcement being made today by HMRC, which would appear to put significant numbers of jobs in Scotland at risk. And in addition to that, Presiding Officer, I will have engagements to take forward the Government's programme for Scotland.
The First Minister has urged people in Scotland to judge her government on its record. So let's do just that. This government established a single police force. We supported that plan, but urged the government to ensure the reform was implemented properly. The report published on Tuesday into call handling in the wake of the M9 crash makes clear that didn't happen. It concluded that there were major weaknesses in the rollout of the new call handling system. Back in April 2013, just weeks after the creation of the single police force, the then Justice Minister, Kerry McCaskill, said there had been a smooth transition. Would the First Minister say today that there has been a smooth transition to a single police force?
First Minister.
Well, obviously, as Kezia Dugdale is aware, and as all members are aware, the report that was published this week was commissioned by the Scottish Government, by the Cabinet Secretary for Justice, to make sure that we were seeking and getting assurances about the operation of Police Scotland call centres, and also making sure that we were identifying so that we can learn any lessons. And that is what has happened in terms of the publication of this report. The report this week makes 30 different recommendations, as the Chamber heard the Justice Secretary say earlier this week. Each and every one of these recommendations has been accepted by and will be implemented by Police Scotland. The review did highlight a number of issues around governance, change management and performance. All of these issues are being and will continue to be addressed. But I think it's also important to note, and Kezia Dugdale and those in the Labour benches may not particularly want to hear this, but I think people watching at home will want to hear this. The report also records the progress that has been made since the review started and also gives some very important assurances on a number of key points. Firstly, that staff levels are stable at the call centres in Govan, Motherwell and Bilston Glen. Secondly, that the grading, the prioritisation and the dispatch for emergency and high priority calls is working well. Thirdly, that risk and vulnerability assessment is strong. Staff training has improved. And these are just some of the assurances that Her Majesty's Inspector has given. So we will continue to make sure that Police Scotland, overseen by the Scottish Police Authority, continues to make sure that the services that are being provided for the public are of the very high standard that people expect.
President Officer, there is simply no escaping the fact that this report is a damning assessment of the government's record on policing. Calls across the country diverted elsewhere, not enough staff at Bilston Glen, which resulted in low levels of performance, IT problems affecting day-to-day operations, a lack of governance of major changes leaving risks unidentified, and an overtime bill that has gone through the roof. The day after Lamara Bell died, the Justice Minister, Michael Matheson, was on the television telling us there were no systemic failings in the call handling process. We now know that simply wasn't true. Following the publication of the report, does the First Minister now concede that there were, in fact, systemic failings?
First Minister.
Firstly, Presiding Officer, and this is a serious point, and I hope people will listen to it seriously. I actually, again today, want to put on record my condolences to the families of both Lamara Bell and John Yule. I'm sure I'm in the same position as everybody else in this chamber when I say that not a single day goes by that my heart doesn't go out to both of these families for the loss they have suffered and for the dreadful circumstances in which that loss occurred. But as the Chamber will be aware, the circumstances of that particular case are still under investigation by PIRC, and the HMICS report was not into the particular circumstances of that case, and that is a point that has been made clear in the report. The report that was published this week is into the wider issues around call centres, and it is, and you know, I would say absolutely frankly to Kezia Dugdale, I'm not trying to escape any facts here. I want to make sure that our public services, whatever they are performing to the highest standards. So it is right for anybody to point in this report to some of the weaknesses and issues that were identified. But if there's to be any sense of balance at all in this debate, Presiding Officer, it is also appropriate to point to the many things that the Inspector says have been dealt with, addressed and improved, and also to point to the key assurances he gives the Scottish public about the operation of call centres. So we will continue to make sure that any issues that require to be addressed are addressed, and the public can have confidence in the services that their police are providing.
Ms. Dugdale. Ms. Dugdale.
It's simply astonishing, Presiding Officer, that even now, with all of that evidence, the First Minister cannot accept that there are systemic failings in Police Scotland. And there's a wider reality here. This is an SNP government which has been pretty timid, because when it comes to our schools and hospitals, they are happy to just manage the status quo. And the single police force is the one major area of public service reform that they have undertaken. And they have got it wrong. And what was the response of the Justice Minister this week? It's all Westminster's fault. The fact is, the Justice Secretary is bang to rights on police failings. He can't lay the blame anywhere else. So can I ask the First Minister, does she still have full confidence in her Justice Minister?
First Minister. First Minister.
Yes, I do. But can I say, you know, this is a really... This is a really...
Order, First Minister.
This is a really... really serious issue.
Order!
And can I say to...
Order! Let us hear the First Minister, please.
I accept absolutely and unreservedly everything that's in the HMICS report. We accept, as does Police Scotland, all of the 30 recommendations. So for Kezia Dugdale to say, as I think she did, that I absolutely refuse to accept what has been found to be the case, is either a deliberate distortion of what I said, or perhaps she was so busy reading our script for the next question that she forgot to listen to the answer that I gave in the question before. I simply pointed... I simply pointed out, Presiding Officer, and again it's a serious point, that the particular circumstances of the tragic M9 case are still under review by the Police Independent Review Commission, and I think that is something that all of us in this chamber should respect. But on the issue of wider public service reform, let me just mention briefly some of the major reforms that are underway under this SNP government right now. I'm not sure if Kezia Dugdale is just completely unaware of health and social care integration. The biggest reform in our health and social care services, perhaps since the health service was established more than 60 years ago. Fire service reform, a reform that was vital, delivered well and performing excellently. The attainment challenge that we've just been talking about. This government recognising the challenge that our public services face and not shying away for a second in equipping our public services for the future. And I repeat, Presiding Officer, I am more than happy to allow the Scottish people to judge my government on its record. Perhaps that's why we see today that 58% of people in Scotland intend to vote for us again next year.
Kezia Dugdale. Ms. Dugdale. Ms. Dugdale.
I think the people of Scotland want to hear a bit less about the polls and a bit more about what she's going to do to support the police. Because, Presiding Officer, the last few months have been some of the worst in the history of policing in Scotland. The resignation of the Chief Constable and the Police Authority Chair. Morale at rock bottom. A third of staff preparing to leave the force. Civilian staff numbers cut. bogus figures over stop and search, a lack of transparency on armed policing, a 20% increase in housebreaking here in Edinburgh, controversy over deaths in police custody, allegations of spying on journalists, and a £25 million budget overspend. Judge me on my record, says the First Minister. What's her verdict on that record?
First Minister. Order. First Minister.
It's not my verdict that counts. It's actually not Kezia Dugdale's verdict that counts. It's the verdict of the Scottish people that counts. And we know at this stage what the verdict of the Scottish people is. But there was one fact in that long list that Kezia Dugdale forgot to mention. And I'm going to be charitable to her and just accept that she forgot to mention it. Here's the fact that Kezia Dugdale forgot to mention. Crime in Scotland at a 41-year low. That's down. That's down to the dedication. The dedication of police officers and police service staff working hard around this country. So Kezia Dugdale is right to hold this government to account. I don't deny that for a second, but it's her miserable approach that denies anything good about this country that sees her and her party languishing in the opinion polls.
Question two. Order. Question two. Ruth Davidson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the First Minister when she'll next meet the Prime Minister.
First Minister.
On the 14th of December.
Ruth Davidson.
Thank you. Presiding Officer, the report by Her Majesty's Inspectorate of Constabulary into the M9 tragedy made several criticisms about the staffing levels in call centres. And as we've heard this afternoon, the report raised many serious issues that require considered examination. However, following its publication, the Justice Minister toured the TV studios and blamed Westminster cuts. So can the First Minister tell this chamber, what was the cash increase in her overall budget last year and what was the cash decrease in the amount she chose to allocate to policing?
First Minister.
Look, the point that the Justice Secretary was making, and one of the points that the Justice Secretary was making, is this one. Because Police Scotland is the only police service in the entirety of the UK that has to pay VAT, then it's paying in the region of
£25 million. Order, Mr. Wheelhouse.
As usual.
Oh, one moment, First Minister. Mr. Wheelhouse and Mr. McMahon, stop shouting across the chamber at each other. First Minister.
As usual, we've got the Labour benches jumping to the defence of the UK Tory government.
First Minister.
£25 million a year is being paid by Police Scotland on VAT that wouldn't have to be if Police Scotland was being treated in the same way as other police services. So we'll continue to make that point because when it comes down to it, Presiding Officer, we will always stand up for the interests of Scotland and people and public services in Scotland in stark contrast to the parties on each of the sides of me today. But going back to the report, this is a serious issue and a serious report into that serious issue. That is why we are accepting all 30 recommendations. It is why we have made sure that the police and the Scottish Police Authority have already started to put right the things that were wrong, which the report recognises. And we will continue to get on with that job of making sure where any weaknesses are identified, they are rectified so that the public has the confidence they deserve to have in their police service.
Ruth Davidson.
Presiding Officer, the figures that the First Minister was looking for, the ones that actually answered the question that I asked, are as follows. Her overall budget went up from last year to this by £661 million, and the sum that the Scottish Government chose to spend on policing in that same period went down by £6 million. The Scottish Government sets its own spending priorities, and clearly policing is not one of those priorities, and you can't blame Westminster for that. This First Minister has sole responsibility for health, sole responsibility for education, for policing and for much else in our society, and she's about to get huge new powers over tax and welfare. This is a government which is always quick to claim credit for every bit of good news, but passes the buck when something goes wrong, as it did in this case. This Scottish Government chose to create a single police force. Their budget this year went up by over £600 million, and they chose to cut the police budget as well. Isn't it time that the First Minister accepted responsibility for that and didn't send her ministers out to the TV to point the finger of blame somewhere else?
First Minister.
Actually, I'm sure the official report will reflect this. The first person to mention Westminster today was Kezia Dugdale, not me, actually. But on the issue of the police was...
Order!
We did...
Order!
We did choose. We did choose.
Order.
We did choose to create a single police service. Interestingly, both Labour and the Conservatives went into the 2011 election pledging to create a single police service, but they don't like to be reminded of that. In terms of the Scottish Government budget, there's been real terms cuts in the Scottish budget by 10%. That is the reality. The whole point, or one of the points, of creating a single police service, of course, was to cut out unnecessary expenditure. So, for example, £1.5 million being saved because we don't have the duplication of 8 chief constables across the country. So we will continue to take the decisions that are the right decisions to make sure all of our public services are on the strong footing that they need to be to face up to the challenges of the future.
Liam MacArthur, constituency question.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. For those of us living and working in the Highlands and Islands, Logan Air is the only provider of scheduled air services. They are a genuine lifeline for many businesses, for patients travelling to hospital appointments, as well as the wider public. Yesterday, yet another Logan Air flight was forced to make an emergency landing, the second in less than a week. I know the Transport Minister takes this very seriously, but given the lifeline nature of these services, will the First Minister now agree to make direct representations to the airline? Will she agree to meet with the Chief Executive of Logan Air to reiterate the need to get the current problems sorted? And will she stress again that regaining public confidence in the reliability and safety of these services must be the number one priority?
First Minister.
I agree absolutely with Liam MacArthur. The services that are provided by Logan Air are, as he has just described them, lifeline services. They are absolutely vital to those who live in our island communities. And there are real concerns about performance. And yesterday's emergency landing, of course, caused considerable concern, not least for those who were on that plane. As he has alluded to himself, Derek Mackay is discussing these concerns and these issues with Logan Air, and we will continue to do so and demand that these issues are rectified. And I would be very happy to ask Derek Mackay to keep Liam MacArthur fully appraised, and I am more than happy to directly make the views of the Scottish Government known to the Chief Executive of the company, because we expect the highest standards for people who rely on these services.
Question 3, Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the First Minister what the impact would be on the Scottish Government's budget if the provisional agreement by the Treasury and the UK Government's Environment, Local Government and Transport Departments to reduce their budgets by 30% over the next 4 years is carried out.
First Minister.
Well, I think it's quite clear that the Chancellor is intent on making cuts, not out of necessity, but out of choice. The UK Government has already cut Scotland's discretionary spending power by 10% in real terms since 2010, and has made it clear that the cuts will continue until at least 2020. The cuts to public services and welfare are having the greatest impact on the most vulnerable in our society. The Scottish Government will continue to do everything we can to mitigate these cuts, but I think it is essential that the Chancellor uses the forthcoming spending review to abandon his austerity politics and support renewed investment in all of our public services.
Kenneth Gibbs.
I thank the First Minister for that answer. Does she agree that Scotland will always be at a disadvantage in any budgetary negotiations with Westminster as long as the UK Government retains the whip hand, and only a mutually beneficial bilateral relationship between governments through an economic agreement such as exists between Spain and the Basque Country will allow Scotland to fully and successfully develop distinctive economic and social policies without fear of UK-imposed cuts?
Well, I think Kenny Gibson makes an extremely important point. You know, the negotiations over the fiscal framework that are underway right now are absolutely critical to making the powers promised by the UK Government a practical reality. The Deputy First Minister has already made it clear that that framework has got to establish a fair, sustainable and satisfactory fiscal settlement between Scotland and the rest of the UK. I agree that financial matters need to be discussed between the Scottish and the UK governments on the basis of an equal footing, with each government treating the other with mutual respect to reach a joint agreement. That's what we're seeking to achieve, and I hope we have the backing of the full Parliament in seeking to do so.
Murdo Fraser.
Thank you. In the House of Commons this week, SNP MPs proposed an amendment to the Scotland Bill to introduce full fiscal autonomy for Scotland. What assessment did the Scottish Government do of the impact on its budget had that amendment been carried?
First Minister.
Well, you know, this is another opportunity for me to make the case that it will always be better for Scotland, for this Parliament and for this Government to have our hands on the levers of political and economic control so that we can build a better country. But you know, I don't think that's the most significant thing that happened in the House of Commons this week. I think the most significant thing was watching Labour troop through the lobbies with the Tories to vote down the devolution of tax credits.
Question four, Linda Fabiani.
Thank you. To ask the First Minister what action the Scottish Government considers needs to be taken to fully realise the objectives of the Equal Pay Act 1970.
First Minister.
Well, on Monday we marked Equal Pay Day, the point in the year where many women are essentially working for nothing for the rest of the year because women on average continue to earn less than men. I think it is a complete and utter disgrace that despite the Equal Pay Act being passed 45 years ago, in the year I was born, in fact, we still don't have equal pay in this country. The Scottish Government is seeking to lead by example. We have made tackling the gender pay gap a priority in our programme for government. We're also working with the Equality and Human Rights Commission to tackle pregnancy and maternity-related discrimination. We're continuing to promote fair work practices and to extend childcare. And I would take the opportunity to call on all organisations and all businesses to take action on this issue so that we can once and for all end pay inequality in Scotland.
Linda Fabiani.
Thank you. Does the First Minister agree that local authorities that have had the same political power in office for years, such as South Lanarkshire Council, have no excuse at all not to have settled equal pay claims on a fair and equitable basis? Does she realise that some of these claims date back for many, many years and continue to cause stress and strife amongst hard-working constituents in East Kilbride and elsewhere?
First Minister.
Well, ministers have repeatedly made it clear, and let me do so again unequivocally today, that delays by councils in settling equal pay claims are completely unacceptable. Many of these claims, as Linda Fabiani has just said, go back to 2006 or even further in some cases. There can be absolutely no justification for taking so long to resolve this issue. There has been some recent progress, such as the settlement of claims against Fife Council, but much more work needs to be done. Equal pay cases need to be progressed with urgency and commitment so that those affected receive their legal entitlements. The Minister for Local Government has written to all 32 Scottish local authorities to reiterate the Government's desire to see more and faster progress and to seek information on the number of claims settled and still outstanding for each council.
Cameron Buchanan.
Very opposite. Often apprenticeships are the first step in career progression. In 2013, analysis from the Heriot Watt University showed that Scotland is the only part of the UK where the number of female starts is persistently lower than the male starts. Why, over the last 3 years, have the number of women starting apprenticeships and the proportion of female starts continued to fall?
I'm not sure that's quite relevant, but if you wish to answer it first.
I'm happy to answer it because it is an important point. I'm happy to provide the most up-to-date figures to the member, but we are working to and increasing the number of women going into modern apprenticeships. And that's just one of many things we need to do to get more women into the labour market, to get more women into jobs, to get more women into full-time, high-quality jobs. And, you know, amongst the job figures we saw yesterday, we saw an increase in full-time work over the past year. So these are important issues. And let me say, Presiding Officer, I am absolutely determined and committed to making sure that we advance gender equality in all its forms.
Question number five, Neil Findlay.
To ask the First Minister for what reason the publication of the findings of the review of paediatric services in Lothian has been delayed?
First Minister.
Well, we're advised by NHS Lothian that the Royal College of Paediatric and Children's Health has advised them that not all of their independent expert review team would be able to begin their work before January. It was originally envisaged that this work would begin this month in November. We support as government whatever steps need to be taken to ensure that a full and thorough review is carried out.
Neil Findlay.
Of course, I'm really sure that the government played no part at all in kicking yet another important review into touch till after the election. But just to be straight with the people of West Lothian, will the First Minister give a guarantee that the current level of service, including 24/7 inpatient services, will be retained and there will be no downgrade of paediatric services at St John's Hospital? Maybe she can chuck away her script and give a straight answer for the first time.
First Minister.
Well, the only person right now talking about closure of these services, as far as I can tell, is Neil Findlay. What we want to do is make sure there is a sustainable service in place. That's why it is right for NHS Lothian to instruct this thorough review. You know, I was the Health Secretary that inherited a position from the last Labour government that had St John's Hospital possibly in terminal decline. It was this government that reversed that, turned that around, and means that St John's Hospital is a thriving local hospital today.
Question number six, Gordon MacDonald.
To ask the First Minister what impacts the proposals in the trade union bill could have on Scottish Government's commitment to fair work.
First Minister.
Well, on Tuesday, this Parliament made very clear its opposition to what is a draconian trade union bill, a bill that threatens the fundamental rights of workers to organise, to bargain collectively and, if necessary, to withdraw their labour. This is an unacceptable threat, not just to trade unions, but to Scotland's strong track record of industrial relations and this government's approach to fair work. That is why we have requested that Scotland is exempted from the trade union bill in its entirety, and I hope we continue to get the support of Parliament in doing so.
Gordon MacDonald.
Does the First Minister agree that it's a disgrace that the Tory government are pushing through this bill, which will have a major impact on devolved services and workers across the country, without any proper engagement with the Scottish Parliament or Scottish government?
First Minister.
Yes, I do. I think this was an issue that was raised explicitly by the Fair Work Secretary in the debate earlier this week. It's absolutely vital that the Parliament can fully consider whether it consents to the application of the Bill's provisions in Scotland. That's why Rosanna Cunningham has asked our legal advisers to explore several possible bases for a legislative consent memorandum and motion. We've never before been in the position where both the UK and Scottish governments have not had an agreement on issues of legislative consent, which I think in itself illustrates the disgraceful lack of dialogue from the UK government on this issue. But there is no doubt whatsoever in my mind that this is a bill that, if it was implemented in Scotland, would have significant implications for our devolved responsibilities. So if the UK government's not willing to exempt Scotland from its provisions, it is absolutely essential that we see a legislative consent motion so that this Parliament, if it so chooses, as I hope it would, can deny its consent to a draconian set of measures attacking our trade unions.
Thank you. That ends First Minister's questions. We are now moving to members' business. Members who leave the chamber should do so quickly and quietly.